worship this morning. Welcome to church. It is good to be here on this beautiful, beautiful day. Will you join with me in prayer? I invite you, wherever you are, just to pause. Take a deep breath. Allowing your body to rest on the earth. Allowing your spirit to rest in your body. Putting our attention on the Creator of all life, on the Holy Father, on the Holy Lord Jesus Christ, on the Holy Spirit, inviting God's presence, inviting our attention and awareness to God's presence. God, we ask that you would be with us this morning, that you would guide our hearts, our minds, our words, our singing, our praying, that we would grow in covenant life with you. In Jesus' name, amen. 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 I want to invite you to pass the peace of God to one another. Just stand up. You can shake hands. You can do a high five. You can do a hug. Welcome. Peace of God with you. Peace. Peace, peace, peace. Peace be with you. Amen. Amen. And let's join together in worship. Just stay standing. Good.
Isn't he wonderful? Sing hallelujah, Christ is risen.
So I was thinking about this next song and what it means to me, as I want to share with you. So when I think back on my life, there are times when you feel overwhelmed, right? So there's things going on in your life. Sometimes it's a lot. Sometimes it's bad, but not too bad. So there are times when you feel like you're overwhelmed and you almost can't breathe. And in those moments, I feel like we can remember that the presence of the Holy Spirit is our air, right? It's the air we breathe. And when he is here, when he's present, none of that matters because he's bigger and he's here with you. So as we sing the song, just remember that he's with you, his presence is here, and he is the air you breathe whenever you feel overwhelmed by anything in your life.
Yeah.
lost without you.
Appreciate our musicians this morning. Amen. Amen. You can have a seat for a minute, and I want to invite up all of our children. Come on up. Come on up. You can come up and have a seat up here with me. Great to see you. Welcome, welcome. Welcome, welcome. Great. So, I was thinking about things that we need. What are some things that we need? Anybody? What's something that we need?
I don't know. Yes. I got it.
What do you think?
Air.
We do. We need air. Let's take a deep breath. Right? We need air. If there's no air, we're going to suffocate. We need air. Absolutely. What else do we need? Anybody?
Water.
Water. Drinking water, right? Yes, absolutely. We need liquid. Our body is made of mostly water, actually. And we need water to keep everything going. What else do we need?
Shelter.
Shelter, right? We need shelter. Now, I just got back from camping last week, so I was sheltered in a tent that had a see-through top, and I could see the stars, which was super cool. But if it had been raining or snowing, I wouldn't have enjoyed that very much, because we need shelter, right? Absolutely. What else? Anybody else? Anybody ever get hungry? Yeah? What do we need when we're hungry?
Food.
Food. We need food. Absolutely. So we need all these things physically, but we also need things spiritually. We get stronger and stronger. The more we know God's love, we need God's love. We need it because it helps us know who we are, know that we're beloved, know that we're God's sons and daughters. And then that helps us be confident and happy and know that there's help when we need it. So will you join together with me in prayer? Just repeat after me. Dear God.
Dear God.
Thank you.
Thank you.
For giving me everything that I need. Especially your presence, which helps me to know myself and as I know you and your love for me. In Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. You got it. You got it. All right. We'll see you after Cubs Club. You guys are going with Miss Christina and Andrea. Amen. Amen. And now, Christy, would you come up? We're going to read the scripture. Come on up. Okay. So we have two scriptures this morning. First one I'll read, and the next one Christy is going to read. So first, a reading from the book of Mark, chapter 6, verses 1 to 18. Listen for the word of God. Jesus went on from there and came to his hometown, accompanied by his disciples. When the Sabbath came, he began to teach in the synagogue, and many who heard him were astonished. "Where did this man get these ideas?" they asked. "What is this wisdom he's been given? How can he perform such miracles?" "Isn't this the carpenter, the son of Mary and the brother of James, Joseph, Judas, and Simon? Aren't his sisters with us here as well?" And they took offense at him. Then Jesus said to them, "Only in his hometown among his relatives and in his own household as a prophet without honor. So he could not perform any miracles there except to lay his hands on a few of the sick and heal them. And he was amazed at their unbelief. And he went around from village to village teaching the people. Then Jesus called the 12 to him and began to send them out two by two, giving them authority over unclean spirits. He instructed them to take nothing but a staff for the journey, no bread, no bag, no money, and to wear sandals, but not a second tunic. And he told them, when you enter a house, stay there until you leave that area. If anyone will not welcome you or listen to you, shake the dust off to your feet when you leave that place as a testimony against them. So they set out and preached that people should repent. They also drove out many demons, and they healed many of the sick, anointing them with oil. Now King Herod heard about this, for Jesus' name had become well known, and people were saying, John the Baptist has risen from the dead. That's why miraculous powers are at work in him. Others were saying, he's Elijah, and still others, he's a prophet, like one of the prophets of old. But when Herod heard this, he said, John, whom I beheaded, has risen from the dead. For Herod himself had ordered that John be arrested and bound and imprisoned on account of his brother Philip's wife Herodias, whom Herod had married. For John had been telling Herod, it's not lawful for you to have your brother's wife.
And now a reading from the book of Luke, chapter 11, verses 1 through 4. One day in a place when Jesus has just finished praying, one of his disciples requested, Lord, teach us to pray just as John taught his disciples. So Jesus told them, when you pray, say, Father, hallowed be your name, your kingdom come. Give us each day our daily bread and forgive us our sins. For we also forgive everyone who sins against us, and lead us not into temptation. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Amen. You got it. Amen. Every time we gather, we have an opportunity to bless God. We bless God with our singing, with our hearts lifted up to him, with our thanksgiving, and we bless God with our giving. We give our tithes and offerings as a way to give thanks for all of what God has given to us, for this beautiful life and everything in it. So I encourage you that to give whatever you can give cheerfully, because God loves a cheerful giver. So if you just are not feeling it this morning, or if you're just here visiting for the first time, please don't feel any obligation. But if you feel cheerful and joyful in blessing God and blessing Woodside Village Church, then we join with you in this practice of disciplined generosity. Amen.
Lost my way, still you're there. guys. Thank you so much. What a wonderful music, and just really appreciate it. You know, music opens our hearts up, allows us to receive and to hear what God has to say to us. And today, I want to help your soul. That's what music does. Music opens us up and helps us receive things. And today, I want to help you with your soul. I actually want to feed your soul, to tend to your soul. Now, our souls are essential to our well-being and to our relationship with God. Scripture says to love God with all our heart, mind, soul, and strength. And our hearts and minds and strength are easy to understand, right? It's kind of like, oh, I get that part. In fact, strength is from the Hebrew word ma'od, and it's like our whole self. Like, we bring our whole selves to this. And that's kind of a summary of that statement there, heart, mind, and soul. But soul is a little difficult to understand. It's a little more complex. Dallas Willard helps us understand this. He says this, what is running your life at any given moment is your soul. Like right now, you may think you are running your life, but your soul is actually running your life. And I think that's an interesting aspect to us. It says this, it's the aspect of our whole being that correlates, integrates, and enlivens anything going on in the self. It is the life center of the human being. The soul is like a leverage point for every individual. If you heal, encourage, even save the soul, you can change and transform a person. That's why God wants us to trust Him with our souls, to attend, to nurture, take care of, and when necessary, make over, feed our souls. Now, tending is such a great word when we think about our souls. Tending means to live or behave in a particular way and to tend to something, to care for it. We don't. My wife's a gardener. Okay, Nicole's a wonderful gardener. And I'll watch her out there, and she's got her hat on, and she's got all her tools. And she doesn't tell the plants to do what they need to do. She actually tends to the plants. And then the plants do their thing. This is, our souls are like that. We tend our souls. We don't direct them. Our souls direct us. And here's the thing, we are already tending to our souls, whether we're aware of it or not. And so Jesus says, let me help you tend to your soul by giving you a prayer. Our souls help us move in a particular way. And that direction that Jesus wants is to move in the way of Jesus. It's why Jesus says, what good will it be for someone to gain the whole world yet forfeit their soul? Or what can anyone give in exchange for their soul? And so today I want to give you a way to tend to your soul, to experience community with the triune God, to look at a special prayer, a holy prayer, a covenant prayer that is the Lord's Prayer. Now, you may have some history with this prayer. How many have a history with this prayer? I just talked to somebody. They said that, hey, when I was in like second grade, I can remember standing and reciting the Lord's Prayer, right? Can you go back and remember this? I sure do. I used to say the rosary as a kid, and I'd say the 10 Hail Marys, and then the Lord's Prayer was the big bead at the end of the 10 smaller beads, right? You guys are familiar with this, so I have this this a lot of history with it, but about 15 years ago, Jesus had me revisit this prayer, and it is really profound. It was actually when I was re-entering ministry. The Lord's Prayer has become like a companion, like someone helping me with a new language. Out of it came a way of life and discipleship, and I can say with confidence that the Lord's Prayer has been the most impactful, meaningful part of Scripture in my life in the last 15 years. And so I want to talk about this, because Jesus sends us out two by two. He helps us move out into the world. What does it mean to be with God before we move out? There is always an invitation of Jesus to say, come to me, before Jesus says, go out. And so a little context here about the Lord's Prayer. It's in Luke, it's in Matthew. It's in the middle of the Sermon on the Mount. And before the prayer, Jesus gives, he says this verse. He starts out, he says, beware of practicing your righteousness before other people in order to be seen by them. But for then you will have no reward from your Father who is in heaven. So he says, do this. He's trying to help us understand to have this time with God alone, to be quiet with God. His warning is about, is nothing, that nothing would get in between or corrupting our relationship with God. And the Lord's Prayer comes in between Jesus' teaching about three ways we practice our faith. He talks about giving to the poor, and he talks about when you fast. And right in the middle is this prayer. The first, giving to the poor, that's like a discipline of engagement. I'm going to go engage with the world. And when you fast, that's what I'm going to be, that's a discipline of abstinence. I'm going to abstain from everything in the world. And right in the middle is this prayer. And Jesus then, and he says this, here's how he introduces it. He says, when you pray, go into your inner room, close your door, pray to your Father who is in secret, and your Father who sees what is done in secret will reward you. Now, it was interesting. Have you ever watched The Chosen? I've mentioned this a few times. Anybody watching The Chosen at all? Okay, so I watched in season three, Jesus is doing the Sermon on the Mount. It's really amazing. It really is. It's so compelling to see it on kind of in action. And he's saying the Lord's Prayer, and he talks about this in secret. And so the only room in a first century house that had a door was a supply room. It may have even had a lock because there were tools, supplies, feed. Probably the least likely sanctified place, okay? It's like your shop, right? But here it is. Jesus says, but this door could be shut. It could be locked, private. The privacy is for us to be with God. And when you are praying, do not use meaningless repetition as the Gentiles do. For they suppose that they will be heard by their many words. God doesn't require a certain initiation right. So I want to be careful that as I talk about the Lord's Prayer, you don't think like, hey, you got to get the words right. C.S. Lewis said this in regards to prayer. He said, words are secondary. They are the movement of the conductor's baton. They are not the music. It's beautiful. Real prayer comes not from manufacturing words, but from falling in love. God accepts our prayers just as they are, because he accepts us just as we are. How do we be alone, be present with God? And so then Jesus says this, pray this way. So I'm going to pass out these little cards right now. I want you to grab a card. Thank my, my boss is good. No, I'm just kidding. My boss is going to pass this out. So I want to pass this out because I believe that in this prayer, we're going to get main themes that God, that Jesus wants us to understand. It's almost like a training in the theology of God, like the theology of who God is, the triune God, and God's vision for us. And so Jesus says, pray this way. And he's about to give us some words that are meant to help us understand, because we do use language. Now, we know the scripture where God knows the groaning. Even creation groans. God knows the groanings in your soul when you don't have the words. But Jesus says, pray this way. And this prayer takes about 30 seconds. I really think it's amazing. It's like 30 seconds. But these words have infinite meaning. It'll take our whole lives to understand this prayer. So let's begin. Jesus begins. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. This is the prayer of relationship, of belonging, and of identity. I belong to God's people. We are in community, our Father. And yet I pray that when I'm alone with God, I'm reminded that I'm not alone. I just had a friend this morning, Elaine sent me this, good friend of ours, about this belonging, this non-belonging epidemic in America. The Surgeon General, there was a quote here from Vivek Murthy, who said, at any moment, half of Americans experience measurable levels of loneliness. And here in this prayer, Jesus is, in 2,000 years ago, he is addressing our loneliness today. He knows the human condition. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. We belong to God's people. We are in community. And this word Abba, it's the most intimate expression of a father. Our father is with us and in relationship with us. It is a beautiful, beautiful expression of the Father. It's the kind of relationship we have with God, infinite, tender, unconditional. And not just my Father, our Father. And usually this is, I think, you know, Jesus knew what this was going to do to the Gentile community. Usually the Father was in charge of the home, right? The Father was in charge. Now, fathers have a Father. Talk about turning patriarchy on its head. You are now not as in charge as you think. The universe is as it should be. God is on the throne, a loving Abba Father in charge, and we are all going to humble ourselves to that. It wasn't like God was a gender. Okay, I just want to make sure I say that. It's about a relationship between Father and Son. God on the throne. And so it's this beautiful picture of God. And hallowed be your name, God's name, hallowed be your name, Yahweh. Scholars believe that Yahweh means he brings into existence whatever exists. What a name. We are worshiping beings. Hallowed is a worship. It's a worship word. And we are worshiping beings. We will worship something. And I believe Scripture teaches us that there's only one safe place to worship, and that's God. Our worship needs to go somewhere. In one line, we have the infinite intimacy of God and the infinite glory of God. My journey of faith, as you know, I just shared that I read the rosary a lot. My journey of faith began with God being big without God being close. When I was 15, I came to Christ and I discovered the relationship with God. But God invites us into both. And maybe for you, one side or the other has been true. God was close, but not very big. Or God was big, but not very close. God is your friend. And here in this prayer, we meet the glory of God and the intimacy of God. And Jesus invites us into that fullness. And we will spend the rest of our lives trying to understand that fullness of God. That's the first part. Really, we're one line in. The sermon's going to take 3 hours. No, I'm sorry. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. These are like huge statements here. Now, God's kingdom means the reign of God's will. And the kingdom can sound confusing, and here's a way to understand it. The kingdom of God is God's vision for humanity. That's all it is. It really is. It's pretty simple. This is God's vision. The kingdom vision is heaven. The kingdom source is Jesus. The kingdom invitation is salvation, and the kingdom way is transformation. Jesus, as the word and message of the kingdom, is the way and power to bring this vision into reality. The kingdom in us, in me, is the invitation to participate in God's kingdom. This is why we talk about salvation. The kingdom on earth as it is in heaven is our transformation individually and in the world. Now, we often separate these out. Have you ever think about how we separate these out? We become fans of one while dismissing the other three. Salvation without God's vision, or vision without salvation, or salvation without Jesus, or Jesus without transformation. They're all a part of it. It's all a part of the kingdom. And prayer is the entry point, the door. We meet Jesus. And we enter into this vision. It's interesting. Jesus, I don't think he ever said, worship me. He actually said, follow me. I'm going to lead you into this kingdom. Follow me. Follow me. Not my will. Your will is the practice of bringing God's kingdom into reality in me and the world. And even the smallest request to the grandest need, we enter the kingdom. Okay, we've just had two huge themes. And then all of a sudden, and really the prayer has this, right? Hallowed be thy name, our Father in heaven, and thy kingdom come, thy will be done. And pretty soon we're going to have trespasses and sins, and we're going to have lead me not into temptation. But right in the middle of the prayer is this very humble phrase, give me this day our daily bread. It's the prayer of trust. Trust is everything in a relationship. At the heart of the Lord's Prayer is this invitation to trust. And Jesus is referring to the proverb about the daily bread in Israel's Exodus when God provided manna. Listen to this proverb in Proverbs 30. Keep falsehood and lies far from me, and give me neither poverty nor riches, but give me only my daily bread. Otherwise, I may have too much and disown you and say, who is the Lord? Or I may become poor and steal and so dishonor the name of God. And it's like he's saying, hey, just give me my daily bread. Jesus is actually teaching right from the Old Testament. He doesn't want us to lose the reality of the physical daily bread God provides and the spiritual daily bread that God gives us. Jesus brings us to the humble table with bread, this table right here that we're going to have at the end. Trusted bread for our souls. It's the humble middle of the prayer. Jesus is the bread of life, the light of the world, the way, the truth, and the life, the vine, the living water, the door, the good shepherd, the resurrection and the life. We trust the bread. It's all the things you brought up in the children's ministry, in the children's sermon, that there are all these things we need. And God knows. God knows. And then forgive us our debts, our sins, our trespasses, as we forgive our debtors, those that sin, that trespass against us. It's not if we do this, it's when we're going to do this. Have you ever noticed that community is messy? Friendship, relationships, they're messy, right? We bump into each other. Jesus is giving us a way to repair relationship. He sees the way. Prayer reminds us that God designed us for relationships, friendship, community. And there are three ways relationships break: debt, sins, trespasses. We use trespasses in the Lord's Prayer. We get trespass from Jesus as he recites his prayer in Luke 11. He expounds on the importance of forgiveness to really drive home this point. He chooses a different word for sin. He says, for if you forgive others their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive others their trespasses, neither will your Father forgive your trespasses. Now, that's a pretty big statement there. Like, oh my, what's going to happen? What does he mean by that? What he's saying is, hey, in relationships, people need a vehicle to experience forgiveness. If they don't experience forgiveness in you, they won't understand or experience the forgiveness that the Father has for them. Matthew chose the Greek word paraptoma to overstep a known and understood limit or boundary, and we call it trespassing. Now, the word debt still matters, but it doesn't have the same edge that it did for our first century leaders, or listeners. In the first century, they had these debtor prisons. Like, if you didn't pay a debt, you'd go to prison. And in Matthew 18, Jesus tells a story about a man who goes into prison. And that's a debtor's prison. And they were often fatal. And so people really feared these things. But trespasses crosses a line, violates another person, dehumanizes. Do you think we're in kind of a day when people feel like, hey, I don't think you're seeing me. I feel like you've trespassed on me. So I think we pray. I like that we use the word trespass and trespasses because it's so relevant today. In forgiving, we become more than competent in the act of forgiveness. We become forgiving people. The world needed a forgiving community. That's the church. We're practicing this. We're becoming forgiving people. Forgiveness is hard. Jesus understood. If we don't forgive, we're not trusting, and that not trusting breaks fellowship in every way. It's an amazing prayer. And now we're at the soul. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. It's the prayer of the soul. Our souls need special attention. We've started from the outside and we've moved into this very deep place. We need God to help us to keep our soul, to deliver our souls. Jesus invites us to bring our deepest selves to God, to trust God to feed our souls so that our souls can direct us. Prayer isn't only what prepares us for the battle. Have you ever heard people say, you got to pray because it's going to prepare you for the battle? Actually, prayer is the battle. If there's one Christian activity that the evil one would want to keep you from, it's from prayer. Jesus' most intense struggles were times when he was praying. The dark night of the soul in the garden, the stressful entering of Jerusalem, overwhelming encounter of the masses, Jesus prays. Jesus could have chosen many things in those moments, but he chooses to pray. He tends to his soul with his relationship with the Father. So how's your soul? What is the invasion in your soul that keeps you from your belovedness, from meeting God, from living in God's kingdom, from living in community? Temptation that keeps you from freedom. Don't be afraid to bring your deepest self to God, to invite God to search and unearth the brokenness. Meet God and ask to be protected from the temptations and evils that lead. And now we're at the end. This last phrase, for yours is the kingdom, the power, and the glory. It's like a summary of the prayer. And it's not in all the manuscripts, the ancient manuscripts. But scholars believe Jesus would have ended the prayer like this. There was a common way of praying. And it's in later in a lot of the manuscripts. And so what's being said here? Well, my kingdom is broken. I want you to know that. Nobody wants to be part of the kingdom of Charley Scandlyn. It's not a good one. It's got all kinds of, you know, all kinds of problems. My power is corrupt. My glory self-serving. This phrase is not in the earliest manuscript, but it's left out. But scholars say that Jesus would use this as a way to, like, maybe summarize the prayer. Your kingdom, your power, your glory. It's a holy prayer. In 30 seconds, Jesus teaches us the way of God, a prayer that transforms our lives, that transforms our understanding of God, ourselves, and the world to draw us into communion with God. A 30-second prayer that invites us into the kingdom, a prayer to see and understand the fullness of God. God wants us to look at him. That is the prayer. That no matter how difficult things get, no matter the failure we feel like we have become, God says, pray, look at me. In prayer, we look at God face to face. He becomes all we see. And the world gets quiet, doesn't it? Gets a little calmer, no matter the words. But in the Lord's Prayer, our eyes are open to God, the kingdom, to the world, to friendship, our belovedness, our souls. It's the power of the Lord's Prayer. And its intent is to invite us into holy prayer. Okay, we're going to pray the Lord's Prayer. I want you to get ready. And I hope you hear it differently today. And that you hear all prayer differently. Would you pray with me? Jesus, thank you that we get to be together. Thank you that we are in community today. And we thank you that we get to be your disciples. And today, just like those disciples 2,000 years ago, when you were on that mount, that little hill, teaching the Sermon on the Mount, we pray the prayer you taught us, saying together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who have trespassed against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Amen.
Take it all. Our word. Okay.
this.
Beautiful. On the night that Jesus gathered with his disciples, he took the bread and, giving thanks to God, he blessed it and he broke it and he said, "This is my body, which is for you. As often as you eat, remember me."
And likewise, Jesus took the cup and he held it and he blessed it. And he said, "This is my blood, the blood of the new and everlasting covenant shed for you and for all humankind for the forgiveness of sin. Take and drink of it and do this in remembrance of me. And as often as you eat this bread and you drink this cup, you proclaim my death and your need for it. Eat and drink. Do this in remembrance of me."
Amen. And we have wine in the large cup and grape juice in the smaller cup. And everyone is welcome. Come up, receive a piece of the bread and dip it in the cup. You're welcome to kneel as you're able or to stand.
Here I am, down on Drench my soul's mercy and grace unfold. A hunger and thirst, a hunger and thirst. With arms stretched wide, I know you hear my cry. Speak to me now, speak to me.
God, we thank you so much for feeding us, for feeding our souls with your word, for feeding our bodies with food and drink, for feeding our hearts with community. Help us to receive your love in all the ways that you pour it out to us, that we may also be fountains pouring it out to others. In your precious name, Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Again, can we just thank God for our wonderful musicians? God bless you. Thank you. Amen. I want to share just a couple of announcements. Today we have a newcomer's coffee after church. If you would come through the courtyard into Guildhall, we have some muffins. You can get a cup of coffee. And just an opportunity to ask any questions about Woodside Village Church, get to know me and whoever else would like to come. If you're a long-timer, you're also welcome. Everyone is welcome. Just come and we'll do a little bit of check-in and questions together in Guildhall. So I hope that you will take a little time to join us after church to do that. This Tuesday, we do not have Bible study. I'm out of town at a conference, actually. And so usually we have a Tuesday noontime Bible study. We'll do that again next week, but just not this week. So, you know, one of the things I also would love to ask everyone to do, if you would take a moment to fill out one of these. We are planning for fall classes in small groups. And if there's anything you're interested in, if we have a number of people that would like to do that, we will... Well, that will help guide us in terms of what classes and small groups we want to do. And if there's anything that you'd like to lead or support, please do let me know that as well. So we're hoping to start those up in early September and would love your input before that. So please do take one of those. You can give them to me or to Nancy. If you would raise your hand, Nancy, afterward. Beautiful. So... Amen. I think that's all by way of announcements. And so now let us receive our benediction, which is a word of blessing. Let's rise. Yes. And now in the name of the Holy Father, our Abba, who loves us intimately, and our Father who is over all, In the name of the Holy Lord Jesus Christ, Emmanuel, God with us. And in the name of the Holy Spirit moving in us, with us, connecting us one to another, empowering us, comforting us, guiding us, strengthening us. May we go forth from here knowing who we are, leaning on God in prayer, and being who God has called and created us to be. In Jesus' name, amen. 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 Let's give God a hand.